And this is Loki's Witch here. I decided to actually do a real video instead of just random little things this week. So this idea actually came to somebody who has my Facebook, who talks to me on my Loki's Witch profile. Obviously not my normal one. Very few people know my normal Facebook, and if they do have it, that's because they're close friends or people who I talk to on a regular basis, such as Hellbound Heathen and Mad, but he's not on Facebook, so we talk all the time on, well, we talk most of the time on Twitter. So the subject that came up was it okay to use tarot cards as a way to talk to your pantheon leader or your deities or whatever you believe? And the main answer to that, yes. It is okay to use tarot cards. It is okay to use any means that you find necessary or available to talk to your deity. You shouldn't let somebody say, oh, well, that's not how I do it, and it's what you feel comfortable doing. You don't have to light a candle on an altar to say something or ask for help from your pantheon leader or the ones that you believe or the ones that you follow or the ones that you are asking questions to. You can use any type of communication, even if it's sitting there thinking to yourself. As for giving them sacrifice or offering or something like that, sometimes it does require an altar, but you can even go to a tree and say, I give this to so-and-so and lay it by the tree. Or bury it under the ground for them. That works too. Or say it and toss it outside into the world, which I do a lot with the like water or wine offerings or even juice offerings. Or on an occasion, for some reason, soda, because what's ever available. And the other thing I was asked was, it was mainly their reasoning for this was because they live in a smaller space where they don't have room for, say, an altar like what I have behind me. Or they live with their family and their family doesn't know they practice, or they just live in a general area where they know if they have it there, it will cause a problem. Or they live in the Bible Belt, as I looked this morning. Well, there's many of options that you can do. And one that Soren told me of was hidden or pocket altars. Like, say you have a cabinet and has a closed area that nobody uses, but you use and it's in your room or your living space. You can make a small altar in there. You don't necessarily need flame-burning candles. You can use the cool little light-up candles. And what I mean by candles that are torchless and to light the little light ones, like this one. Look, it's kind of cute and neat and like that. And you just have to supply batteries for it. And it does count as a candle that you can use for rituals, because guess what? You'll never run out of it. And this one's actually a gelatin one. Have you noticed? Yeah. Bouncy. It's kind of cool. We actually found it at the Dollar Tree for a dollar. So this is going to go also under my file of for the broke witches. You can find light-up candles, battery candles anywhere. Most of them have the slot on the bottom where you can change out batteries. It normally takes a standard watch battery. Or it can take a AA, a AAA. You can find bigger ones that take D batteries. Those are almost like flashlight-esque, but they're thick and they're pretty cool. And you can get them in white or any color or anything that they offer at that store or any place. I mean, like I said, we got this for a dollar. And Soren actually likes it because they can use it repeatedly and use it for the summer without having to light a candle and cause extra heat in the house. Another good alternative for if you have a closet altar is candles like these that are pre-in jars. You might see these at grocery stores all the time, but they're normally white. I have some red ones. I have some blue ones. I have a yellow one somewhere. I had a green one for a while, which was awesome. I found these at our local Dollar Trees. Literally, the store is named the Dollar Tree. And they sell them for a dollar. I actually have two burning on my altar behind me. And yes, I'm using red mostly for the season. And sadly, I didn't have any green, so they get the red holly. Well, holly berries. But they are good candles. They last a while. I think I've had these on here since the start of December. And it's midway, almost into the month, and they're not even burned down more than this. Actually, a little less than this, so from the top. And you will have to get a lighter, sorry, like this, to go in when it goes down lower for the wick. And both of those items I actually got at the Dollar Tree. Another good little bargain. But you can get any little item that you would find on any altar like this and put it in a hidden altar. It doesn't have to be a big space. It can be a little space. It can be a little shelf. It can be a little cubby hole. It can be anything. We have a small stand for our healing altar, which it duplicates as one of my second altars in the house, that sometimes junk gets put on it and we tend to remove it. After a few days of realizing, oh crap, that's not supposed to be there. But we've been working better than to have it as a catch. Crap catch. Everybody has those in their house, and normally it's by their front door. But with these altars, it's stuff that you light for healing for others. That's what I have for our little house healing altar. But it's a smaller altar, so I can't put too much stuff on. We normally have fresh flowers on it, which is okay. Flowers can be a offering as well, and you can put those suckers anywhere. Put them on your table, put them on your nightstand, put them by your TV. You can put flowers anywhere and just dedicate them to. It can be a hidden offering. Artwork can be an offering too. And it doesn't have to be like mine, which is an altar setup that I painted actually in class, which my teacher was confused about because he didn't know what it was. And then after I explained it, he was still confused. And then I explained the whole pagan Wiccan thing. And he's like, oh, that's cool. That's awesome. You can put it into art. And walked off not really understanding what the hell I said. But at the same time, I'm pretty sure he was stoned half the time in class. But he's a great teacher. As for the thing of, well, I can't have one because I'm broke. Or I don't have enough money for this. Or I move around a lot. Well, when I lived with my parents, I was not allowed to have candles in my room because of something stupid I had done when I was about 6-7 years old. Mind you, 6-7 year old brain, not the smartest thing in the world. What did my smart ass do? Well, I decided to light a piece of newspaper on fire and see how quickly it would burn. Well, it burned too quickly in my hand, and before I could get literally 2 feet to the fireplace, I had dropped it on the carpet in front of said fireplace and burnt a little patch in the carpet. Well, instead of being a smart kid and sitting on the burn mark to hide it, and then getting scissors and cutting that area out, because honestly you couldn't tell, because that's all the person did that fixed the carpet was cut off the burn part, and it looked like it never happened. Yeah, I was smart and jumped into the recliner and faked like I was sleeping and blamed it on the dog or my little brother who wasn't even at the house at the time. Yes, who was grounded from anything that lit fires until they were over 18. But it didn't mean I didn't have it. I had a plethora of lighters and matches. I just never used them in the house. Because one, I liked not being grounded, and two, I liked having a little bit of freedom. What I did in lieu of that was my mom did, when I asked for it, would buy me battery-lighted candles. Because she's like, you know what, she's a teenager, she's a young adult, it's okay, she's not going to do anything stupid, but still fire candles were not allowed in my bedroom because of the simple fact of I was a forgetful child as well, and I could easily walk out and leave it burning. And there was no loopholes to this, and even to this day, I think I'm not allowed, but the last time I was with them, they allowed me to. So when I was younger, it was a no. So when I started practicing, I did a lot of myself on what I like to call a traveling altar as well. Sorry, something got in my eye. And what I did was is I got a bag or a box or a bowl or something similar to this, which is another hand-me-down object that we got for Christmas last year from a friend. And yes, it needs cleaned, but it's from a friend. And I would put my stuff in it, including my small candles, my stones, my everything I needed for what I was going to do. And I'd go outside, and we had flat little pillars by our driveway that I would use, set up as my full moon altars. Give or take the weather, but normally in California, it was about what, 60, 70 degrees at night for Southern California. Anyone who lives in Hemet, California will understand that, including in December. And so I would do my rituals out there. I wasn't afraid. I wasn't worried. We didn't have anything bad really happen in our neighborhood anyways, so it didn't bother me. Didn't bother my parents because I was burning my candles outside. I wasn't setting anything on fire. I was being responsible. But I would pack everything up after I was done, put it back in my little box, and take it back to my room. I was a very neat and organized teenager at that point. Well, teenager, young adult. I really didn't get into a lot of my stuff until more out of high school. I did a little bit while in, but not a lot. Mostly because I was still Mormon then, and I still cling to the hope that it would help me with other issues that I was having, which in the end, it really didn't. But enough with that. So when it comes to, well, I can't have an altar because of this, there's loopholes. But if none of those options work for you, you can still do, even in your room or anywhere actually, a traveling altar. Take it with you to the woods, or take it with you when you go on a personal hike, or when you go out, or when you're by yourself, use the kitchen table or something like that. You can make an altar out of anything, and it can also be a breakdown altar. You don't need a permanent altar. Yes, they're nice to have because it's easier than storing all your stuff in a box. But I understand where people are coming from on that. But you don't necessarily need an altar either to commune with your deities. You can use many things. You can use tarots, you can use water in different jars. Like you said, you can use tarot cards. This is one of my decks. It's actually a very elaborate deck, and I don't use it that often. It's more my personal deck than it is the one I read, and I've shown people the one I've read before, which is the Morgan Tarot, I believe it is. I would have to go grab it. It's over at my normal setup. But you can use cards that are more akin to yourself than to use on others for that purpose. You can use stones. I have green, blue, orange, yellow, white, and red selenite in here, but you can use stones. You can use runes by casting runes if you know how to cast them and if you know how to read them. Like I said, you can use bottles that you can put different oils and waters in and open it up and say your thing to your deity, and it will count as an embodiment of your deity. And I do have a lot of people asking me, well, I have a statue of so and so. Does that count as an embodiment? What I say to that is anything can count as an embodiment of your deity. It's not that you're worshiping the statue, that's just the representation. This can count as a representation for Loki. Yes. It can. Doesn't matter what it is. Like I said, if you have a hidden altar that you have to a deity that you can get a toy of, like Loki, Thor, Hercules, Odin, Hades, any of them that have been used in mainstream media and there's toys for them, or even Clash of the Titan toys, you can use them. Yes, it may be harder to get a hold of them Sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't, depending on the deity. You can use Jack Skellington and Sally as your lord and lady if you needed to. Yes, I do own this, and I was so happy to get it. But this can be used as a representation, believe it or not. It doesn't matter. It's a representation of Loki. There is millions of representations of every god. And you go, well, don't you have that big, nice, fancy BAM? Yes, I do have this nice little BAMF right here. And this was because of my mother-in-law. And yes, it's more of the accurate Viking version of Loki. And everybody's going to go, well, he has horns on his helmet. He is depicted with the ram horns. He's also depicted with an axe, if you notice, instead of a spear. This is a Polarn halberd axe. Not the normal short axes that sometimes you see Thor with. Sometimes you see Odin with. Sometimes you see Baldur with. But he has a halberd axe. And that is fine. That is one of the weapons he is known for. Like Thor is known for not only the hammer, which I cannot pronounce his name to save my life. And also with an axe, and they both represent fertility. And eventually, and I will do this actually on a different thing with Logan and Matt, I will bring up my button that is the lesbian adopted symbol, which is a double-sided battle axe. And trust me, when I first saw it, I said, hey, this means gay Viking, doesn't it? I was wrong. And I am a member of that community because I am a lesbian with a non-binary person. So, yeah, there's that. But it can be a representation regardless of what it looks like. It can be this. It can be this. It can be a bottle with oil and water, or just a bottle, or just water. It can be anything you want the god to represent. It also, well, or goddess. It also can be a candle. And yes, I've done candles representing god and goddesses all the time. Before I had Loki, before I had Bridget, I had candles in their place. That was my representation of them. Hers was normally blue or white, and his was normally red or purple. Or green. Another thing for you broke witches out there. Costume shops and Dollar Tree are your friends. This was part of a Halloween costume. I have since made it silver and did it in the front leaf because it works better for goddess representation when I'm stuck centerpiece as one when doing group rituals. This got from a great little store called Value Village that went out of business. Is an offering urn is what I'm using it for. And yes, it was cheaply dyed. But it was like that when I got it. And I will eventually probably do the glue and food coloring to re-dye it so that nothing is showing. But it works. You just gotta clean it and cleanse it. This I got for 50 cents at the same place. Thrift stores are your friends. You just gotta clean them and repurpose them because this is my offering cup. And that's actually two parts of my traveling altar. Another little handy-dandy thing is collecting things. I collected seashells from the shore here actually in Vancouver. We are by the Columbian, and obviously there are fish and other little life that live in shells. I collect those, and I use those in the summertime on my altar. I represent water. Bulk buy candles. This is just a single from a pack. I bought a pack of bulk candles from a grocery store for $10. Then I went to a different place and bought a baggie full of random candles for $2. Thrift stores are your friends. A lot more than some places. But if you're looking for specific colors, you can go to Walmart. You can go to Dollar Tree. You can go to a normal mainstream store and get those things. Another thing. Yes, this thing. I do have a rather large affleme. This is not my first affleme. This is actually my second one. Nope. The rule. and I know how to use it softly so I don't poke anything. My sides of my applique actually are sharp because I bought it in state in California, and stores can sell their double bladed items like this sharpened if you're over 18. Yes, it does have the moon symbols on it. The main reason why I got it, you can find this anywhere. This is actually a generic print out one, which it's a nice applique, and I was lucky enough to get one that actually came with the bell hook, the hip hold. Not the best hip hold because it kind of leans this way, and I've used it on costumes before too. My first applique cost me $5, and that one cost me $20. This little guy. Because he went with my pocket altar, and he goes with my pocket altar and the house altar. Yes, he kind of does need a wax cleaned off of him, but from the last ritual we used him at. But it is, as you can see, rather small, easily concealed, easily to hide, and easy to, well, take with you places. Yes, it does have a belt clip on it. This one is slightly sturdy, just that I don't trust this to hold in this, of this part, to hold in the blade completely, because it can go that way and come out. So anytime I had worn it with anything, I had altered this around and put a string around this and around the applique, so it wouldn't come out. But this is just as useful as this. This is better in big group circles if you have to wave it around and all that weird stuff. Yes, both. This is actually dull from use. I have to get it sharpened again. It is tipped. It does have a sharp tip still. Either of these are acceptable. A kitchen knife is acceptable. If that's all you have, that's all you have. Another thing is, well, I want to make moon water or holy water, but what am I going to store it in? As you know by most of my past videos, I do enjoy the libations of alcohol. I never mix it with rituals, though. I've never known anyone for that to be a good idea unless it's just a sip of something from a cup and you're passing it around. But this is a bottle from Kraken Rum. What we did is after we used it, we rinsed them out. We removed as much as we could. I still got some of the sticky stuff on here. The label. I obviously didn't remove this part because it was helping the bottle. And this is what we use to stir moon water in. We also use mason jars. We also use the long cork bottles like I have on there. You can use any bottles. This was just a reuse instead of throwing it away. Good way to recycle things. And this is actually moon water with stone. So it's stone moon water. Reusing items is perfectly okay. Or I got that for $1 at the Dollar Tree as well. The candle holder thing next year holding up the orb, I got that at thrift store for $2. And even if you're doing all this on a budget, there is one thing that I even shell out money for every year because it actually is helpful and it is a reminder and it makes it where I don't stop and go, oh crap. The witch's calendar. This works for pagans, it works for witches, it works for Wiccans, it works for anyone, because in it, it has, obviously, very nice illustrations, stuff that goes on during that month, and some ritual information, and down on the months, it has all the moon phases, it has what time a certain sign rises, and what time a certain sign falls, what the day and significant is, like right now, it's showing August, so on here, it shows the cold moon, well, the full moon, the fact that it's the corn moon, and there's a lunar eclipse that day, and it shows about what time, what degree, what angle. It also shows it's the second rising of Aquarius, and the full moon is supposed to be at its peak at 2:11 that day. I believe that might be central time, I'm not 100% sure, but it does have the best harvest day, the best plant days, too, on the days as well. This is my third year having it. It was hard for me to find. I had to go to a calendar store and ask them if they had it. Because their kiosk no longer did. Sometimes you have to order it online. excuse me, which I'll leave the link to that below, along with their Facebook. And no, I am not associated with them. I'm just pimping them out because they have a great product, and it has been a lifesaver. I will fully say this calendar, we have one up right now, has been a lifesaver for me to remember certain dates, certain moons, certain phases, certain things. And it helps if you actually do spells by, it has to be this setting and this setting. It is good for that, if you're that strict on your spells. But it also gives a lot of helpful information. And sometimes it does have quirky little recipes for like a cucumber spell water, which actually tastes really, really good, and I'm not lying there. But it is a handy thing to have on hand. And I would suggest it, and it does show different artists and different people who wrote these things or made the illustrations. Like I said, it is a good one to have. They've been out since 1998. And they also have mini books and stuff like that. And enough about that, but that is one thing I do pay a little extra to have. Another thing, as you notice, are my orbs and my newer one. This was $80. This cost me $80, $90. And it's not bad. It is selenite, so I cannot get it wet whatsoever. Unless I want to lower it, make it smaller, but I don't want to. Most of these I did not pay full price for. That one should have been a lot more than what he charged me. He only charged me $40 because he knew how much I loved it. These, I have two eggs. Technically, I had three. I had bought them from Goodwill for $5. All three. One is with a former roommate of mine. A lot of things on my altar, even the silver cup that cost us $1 from a thrift store, holler for $1. Most of these things you can find anywhere, depending on the price or depending on how well you know the store owner. I just so happen to know the people at Celestial Awakening very well, and I get awesome discounts and told when certain things come in. Another thing that I have for my altar and my personal self is a journal. This little journal, yeah, I had to wait a few months for it to come in. I ordered it online from an app, but it has little paper, and you can change the paper to whatever you want. You can change it to note card paper if you want. It comes with, this one came with a little, some brown, roughly made paper, but it works. And these things are easy to put in my pocket and carry everywhere. But it's like, oh, that's too small. No, smaller sometimes the better. Then I do have a bigger one that right now is bookmarking a place and a book of runes for me. The thing is if you look at this, this is one of my first tools I ever got. My pendulum. And you can see where I have a break in it. And you can also see that it is moving on its own, and I'm doing my best not to move it, even though my hand is shaking. I'm being held up, but I fix it with a copper wire. It's another way to give thanks or talk to a deity. You can subconsciously hope that that's what's talking to you about it. You can go, show me yes. Show me no. Are you so and so? And it will say yes or no. And right now it's saying yes because he's being a dick. Even though I know what's in this. Oh, yeah, you are. Stop it. But a lot of the times people will go, well, you need specific things to do rituals and to have this and that. No, you don't. You just need yourself, your own energy, clear mind, clear thoughts, and it'll be fine. And yes, sometimes they go in circles, either counterclockwise or clockwise. Yeah, it's being annoying. So, To answer your question about not being able to have an altar, or what's alternative for altars, or to give sacrifice, or to give thanks, or to talk to a deity, it is what you seem fit in the end. You can have an elaborate altar, elaborate statues, elaborate objects on there that you pay big bucks for, or you can be like most broke witches, like myself, who, when we do get money, we go out and blow it on an $80 orb instead of food. Anyways, which I actually would not say make yourself bankrupt and buy all these things. No, if you have a little bit extra that you can spend on stuff, do it. If you know you're going to need that money for something else, maybe put that aside then. Do what you think is best for you and not what you think is best for your deities. Because in the end, it's about you, not them. And if all you can do is set up tarot cards as a way of talking to them and hoping your answers come through the cards, then do that. If your only way to talk to them is your pendulum, then do that. If it's a spirit board, do that, but be careful with that one. Even with the pendulum, you have to be careful. They can both open gates. They can both let good or bad things in if you're not careful. And I say gates instead of barriers or doorways because, well, gates actually look a lot cooler than a door. And you can hear them yelling from the other side and see what they are. But even with cards, you can do the same thing. But any way that you do it is your choice and your making. Don't let somebody tell you just because it's what they believe that you need to do it this way, that that's the only way and that's the only correct way. No. There is no right or wrong way to commune with your deity. And don't let anyone say that you're doing it wrong when you're doing it the way you do it, not the way that they are doing it. So a lot of this stuff is about yourself, empowering yourself to do these things and find your own path in life. And when I read cards to people, I explain that these are paths that you have a choice to choose that may turn out in your favor, may not. It's not for sure. They have meaning to you more so than they do me, and more so than what they do when they get laid out. That's how cards work. You got to remember that. Same thing with yes and no questions or spelling out something on a board. These things are all viable for you, and you have to realize you may not be the one pushing them. Your deity may not be the one pushing them or answering you. It could be anything. It could be your subconscious coming through saying, this is what you need to do. But one thing you need to have is, well, trust in yourself. If you can't trust yourself, then who can you trust? Do what you find you need to do. Don't let anyone else decide your path for you. And if you're struggling with, well, should I follow this pantheon or this pantheon? Or, oh, this one looks good. Or should I stay with my Irish roots? Or should I stay with my dramatic roots? Should I stay with my Roman, Italian, Greek, whatever roots you are? Or even Native American roots, which sometimes Sauron does. That's why we have a lot of dream catchers. Do what you feel you need to do. Not what your roots call for you to do. What you feel like you need to do. If you feel like you need to be with the Greeks, go with the Greek pantheon. Roman, go with the Roman. Italian, I'm not sure on that one. Celtic, Irish, Scottish, Nordic, Viking. Well, Nordic, Viking are the same. You know what I mean there. Hispanic, Mayan, Native American, any roots that have deities. There are so many pantheons out there. And I haven't even studied all the pantheons, people. I know more about Greek, a little bit about Roman, a lot about Nordic, and some about Native and Some Hispanic, but not a lot. No, I have no clue what Santa Maria is. So please stop asking. I'd have to look it up. And right now I'm not. But do what you find you need to do. And yes, I know things about the Celtic pantheon that I don't let on to right away, but they also have more deities than I have cards in this deck. You have to follow what you believe. And if that's you want to follow Oderon and his Garden of Fairies, do so. If you want to follow Thor, Odin, Frigga, Friget, do so. If you want to follow Zeus, Hades, Persephone, Hera, Hercules, do that. If you want to do their counters, which is Jupiter, Mars, Venus, Mercury, all them, do that. It doesn't matter. Do what you feel you want to do. You don't have to stick to just one pantheon. You can mix them. I have Celtic and Nordic on my altar. Soren has Greek and Hispanic on their altar. Our house altar is any deity. And the room altar is, well, that's Soren's, and I actually have no clue. They've never keyed me in on who that main deity or what they use for that, besides their normal spell work. That's their choice. Their main altar in the living room is known as Hades' altar. So you can work with as many deities as you wish. And yes, you're going to find one or two that are going to be jealous of each other. That's going to happen. But maybe a hidden altar that you have, one that you tear down every time after you use, one that you have permanent in your house dedicated. It is yours. No one else's. So what goes on that altar is your choice. And yes, you can and be influenced by other people going, well, they do have a good idea. I might want to try that. Then do it. If you like their idea, run with it. It's not only their idea, it's if they put it out into the world, it's gonna be used. I mean, yeah, I would love for other people to use some of my ideas. I'm okay by that. Most everyone would be. Do what you do, not what others make you do. And I'm probably gonna end right there because a little bit of it feels like a little bit of rant and a little bit of explanation, but it kind of is because, granted, those two questions in one is one of those 40-minute long videos answering because it's hard sometimes to put into words. But like I said, anything that you feel you have and want to use for a representation or a way to commune or a way to show an altar or something is your choosing. It can be anything. But until next time, I hope you guys have a happy and safe weekend that's coming up. New Year's weekend is coming, and I plan to be on Heathen Haven on the 1st. We are doing our first of the year episode where we're continuing a series that even I had to watch to catch up on, and I'm sitting here going, my brain just melted. It's not that I like criticizing people who say everything is evil from a candle is the light of Satan to saying Pokemon are going to turn our kids into Satanists. They're going to the devil with these things. They're horrible role models. It's a cartoon. I just help point out things and go, no, that's the wrong information. Why are you saying those things? Why? Let me try to correct them, even though we're pretty sure they'll never watch our video and never take our correct or our criticism very well. If they did, it would be a miracle. But you'll see me there with Hellbound Heathen. and the Mad Witch. And normally they call me Loki, or they actually call me by my given name, which is what most people know as Crystal. I'm leaving out my last name for very good reasons. But you guys will normally see me there on Sundays at 7, I believe, we're Pacific? Yeah, Pacific time. So add that into whatever time zone you are and add an hour or two. But I will be on there with them, and no, I will not be drinking because I would have had done all my drinking the day before, or that Friday of, because of bowling. And I know my little brother may or may not see this video, so happy birthday, and boy, it goes uphill, I promise. He's my little brother. He's 2 years younger than me, and I kind of do miss a little turd. But his birthday will be, well, actually is today, the 27th. And I know it's going to be an odd time in the morning, me posting this 4 or 5 a.m., but that's also because I'm on a really weird sleep schedule because I'm sick. So I slept all day. Thank you, Codeine Cough Syrup, for keeping me from coughing my head off and knocking me out. And that's another thing, pagan or not, if you're sick, please visit a doctor. Please get checked out. Please get antibiotics if you need it, because mine has become a very bad earache. And if I didn't get antibiotics, my eardrum probably would have ruptured, because that's the normal thing with my ears. Lovely, isn't it? But regardless of all those things, I want everybody to have a happy, safe weekend. Enjoy everything, and happy new year, and, well, happy Hanukkah for those who celebrate Hanukkah, and happy whatever else is going on this week, because, hey, every day is a celebration, right?